This video is for section 32.3, driving an inductive load with a field effect transistor. Let's take a look at what the problem is. We have a power supply. Let's call that VDD. We'll have an inductor. And because this is the real world, it will have some resistance. And we will have a field effect transistor. In particular, this will be an NFET with its source connected to ground. And we're going to be interested in looking at the voltage here across our entire load. So VDD minus VD is going to be our voltage. And we will have a current through the inductor that we're interested in looking at. Generally, for inductive loads like motors and loudspeakers, the current is often the most interesting thing about the electrical behavior there, and what controls the... All right, so we're going to be controlling this with a gate voltage. When the gate voltage is high, we turn this transistor on and get current to flow. When we turn it off, by turning the gate voltage low, transistor stops getting any current through it, and there shouldn't be any current through the inductor. It's not quite that simple, so let's take a look at what happens both when we turn it on and when we turn it off. So I'm going to look at two plots. One is, what is the voltage on the drain? And the other one is, what is the current through the inductor? And we'll start with the transistor having been off for quite a while, so there's no current flow. All right, so we're going to have no current flow. If there's no current flow, there's no voltage across the resistor, nothing across the inductor either, and the voltage here is going to be just up at VDD. All right, what happens when we turn the transistor on? Well, when we turn the transistor on, we can get a large current through here, and the voltage in VD can drop very rapidly. So this voltage will drop. What does that mean in terms of the voltage across the inductor? Well, it's going to be VDD minus VD. VD's just dropped close to zero, so we've got VDD across the inductor. And so we're going to get a current flow. DI DT is initially VDD over L. If there's a large inductor, well, I've drawn the current as flowing this way, so that is in fact the right direction. The current is going to increase with this slope. Large inductor, slow rise, small inductor, rapid rise. But as the current increases, the voltage across the resistance increases. And that means the voltage across the inductor decreases. When we've got this sort of voltage equation, this sort of differential equation, just like we had for charging a capacitor through a resistor, except we swapped the roles of current and voltage, we're going to get an exponential charging curve. And so this curve is going to go up, reach an asymptote. The asymptotic value here that it's aiming towards, so out at time equals infinity, is going to be VDD over R, or more correctly, R plus R on, the on resistance of the gate. Because what's going to happen with the voltage here is initially it drops, but as the current builds up, we're going to have a little bit of increase on here, and the voltage here is eventually going to be I infinity times R on. And you can write that as VDD times R on over R on plus R. So just voltage divider, resistor here, the inductor no longer will be doing anything. There'll be no voltage drop across it. So as you can see, this is not quite as simple as we might like for a simple resistor being turned on, but it's still pretty straightforward. As we turn it on, and it doesn't, the current doesn't instantly jump, but builds up to its eventual value and then stays there. Turning things off, a little bit more complicated. Let's take a look at that. So, for turning things off, we're still going to do the same sort of voltage on the drain, current through the inductor, but now we're starting at low voltage here, maybe a little bit more than zero because the on resistance, the transistor here, but a pretty big current. What happens when we turn this transistor off? Well, no current flows through the transistor anymore, but there's still current flowing through that inductor. Where is it going? Well, there's always a little parasitic capacitance everywhere. So what we're going to do is we're going to charge up that parasitic capacitance. What happens if you have a large current and small parasitic capacitance? Well, you charge it up very fast. The current's still flowing. We keep charging up that capacitor. Now, as we start charging this up and we get above the VDD voltage that we started at, now we're getting a negative voltage across that inductor. That's going to cause the current to start flowing, to start reducing. As the spike gets higher and higher, this gets steeper and steeper, and eventually stops charging this capacitor, and we get the voltage dropping back down to VDD and the current dropping to zero. This jump, which goes well past VDD, is called an inductive spike. And it can get huge. You can get 50, 100 volts easily off of a 3-volt power supply by turning off the inductor and having the current flow until this spike here has had a chance to reduce it down to zero. We don't usually want to have those huge spikes running in our electronics. A lot of our electronics isn't designed to handle huge voltages. It's much cheaper to handle low voltages. So there is something we can do about that, and that is, if we have some place for this current to go, it doesn't have to just charge a capacitor, if it could be taken away somewhere, then we wouldn't have to have such a big spike. And a simple way to do that is to add a diode. That diode, under normal operation, when we're just turning the transistor on, is reverse biased. VDD is our highest voltage. Nothing flowing through the diode behaves perfectly normally. But once this inductive spike starts, and this voltage here starts rising, well, once we get up to one diode drop, about 0.7 volts above VDD, that diode starts conducting. And now, we're no longer charging the capacitor, we're just dumping current through that diode and the resistor here. And what's going to happen is the current will drop, and how fast it drops depends mainly on what's the resistance of this resistor, what's the resistance of the diode. Smaller the resistance, the faster it'll drop. But if it's a large resistor, it'll drop slowly, because it takes a while for things to dissipate. And so this will drop down, and we will get a longer but lower spike. Essentially, all the energy that's stored in the inductor when you turned it off has to be dissipated in this inductive spike. you can dissipate it by very rapidly having very high voltage and having the resistor dissipate, you know, power is V squared over R. So if the voltage goes up very high, you can dissipate that energy very quickly, high power. Or if the voltage is kept lower, it takes a little bit longer because V squared over R is still what the power level is, and we still have as much energy to get rid of. So the total energy in this spike and in this spike is the same. It's the energy that was stored in the inductor. One of them is just spread out longer so that it doesn't get as high, and we can protect this rest of the circuitry by dissipating the energy more slowly. That sort of diode goes by many different names. It can be called a snubbing diode. Because we've snubbed the voltage here, kept it from getting too big. It's also sometimes called a freewheeling diode. Because if this inductor is a motor, what happens is that the motor continues to spin as long as that current can still be flowing through there. And we almost always need to have some sort of diode like this when we are driving an inductive load, because those spikes really are a serious problem. And you do not want them propagating through your system. You want to make sure that there's always some place for the current to go when you turn off the inductor. We'll look at another way of handling this that is a little bit more powerful than just a single low side switch, where we'll be able to drive the inductor in both directions, something we'd want to do for a motor or a loudspeaker. And we'll look at that in a subsequent video. So I think that's it for this one.